Alrighty, ladies and gentlemen, we are back. We're gonna be getting on into Murloc Geniuses, the combined team of Evil Geniuses and Murlocs Incorporated. Actually, I think it's Murloc Geniuses Incorporated. I might be wrong on that.
Well, they actually don't have any of the Murloc players with them now, because it was pretty much just Caterpillar, and he's playing with Complexity today, I believe. So it's actually just like three-fifths of the last iteration of Evil Geniuses plus Rajar and Echo, who, Echo at one point... Actually, I guess Echo was Murlocs before, so you can kind of give them that. I don't know.
Yeah.
And then I don't recognize a single person on the other team, so this will be exciting.
Neither do I, but they've got such a great name. That's the only reason I think we're doing this match, is just because I just love their name. Of course, Kappa Wolves will be moving on to go fight Complexity. And then from then on, we're going to be getting on to the round of eight. So tonight, we're going to be going on into the two arc gaming game, which is going to be the top half of the round of eight in the next game. And then the winners of Cloud9 Vortex versus Team Detonation is going to be whoever two arc gaming is going to be going against. And then we're going to be going on into, after that, the bottom half of the round of eight, which is going to be Shots and Bullets Reloaded versus the winner of Tempo Storm versus Goon Squad. All of these games are going to be best of three today, and then tomorrow is going to be the semifinals, and then the finals. Those are all going to be best of five, so do yourself a favor. Follow this channel, mlg.tv/sham2 or Titan Arena. Either of them lead to the same place. Follow the channel to know when we go live tomorrow, as well as follow the lovely Idra, which, I think everybody in the gaming universe follows you already, or myself, sham2, S-E-H-A-M-T-O-O, to know when those games go live. We'll be tweeting those out appropriately. So, with that, yes we are.
Do we have the draft link?
Yes, the number is 3187.
Okay.
So, as soon as we get that draft ready to go, yep, both those teams ready to go, let's go head on into the draft. So, Murloc Genius is going to be taking first pick over their opponents because they are the higher seed. That is up to the higher seed to determine in the game first game. That's how the rule set works for this tournament. After being yelled at by a couple of pros, they're just like, hey, it's not actually a huge advantage to be first seed still, so can we talk about this? And, we had some discussion, so let it be known that I am merciful when it comes to,
Well, you're going to get yelled at again as soon as the meta switches, because then it'll be better to have choice of map or whatever.
Yeah.
It's so hard to actually find rules that will hold consistently when the meta is changing every month like that.
Right.
It's pretty much impossible to satisfy everyone constantly.
Always impossible to satisfy everybody. But I try to do what I can.
Lost Vikings, man. We actually didn't see Lost Vikings during any of those last three games. And I think they're one of maybe the better responses to the Diablo Toronto stuff just because, you don't really want to try and kill them, and it's pretty hard to do so even if you want to try. So, in retrospect, I'm kind of surprised we didn't actually see that in any of those games.
That's true.
Well, Illidan's off the board, and Murlocs... I don't know, we call them Murlocs Geniuses? Well, I guess Murlocs. They have the Jaina, so it's worked out well for them so far. The Diablo Taranda is up if Keith McBrief wants it.
Wow, really quick lightning pick so far. Cursed Hollow is going to be the map. And in case anybody's actually interested, if you want to know what the bans were, it was Mines, then Tomb, then they banned Dragon and Garden. So... Go to Matt. Mines. Of course, Mines is the first ban. But yeah, let's talk about this draft a little bit more. So we see Jaina, Uther, Taranda coming out here from Murloc Geniuses.
Keith is going to have a really, really bad time if they don't take Diablo here. But if they do take Diablo, they don't have anything to put with it. So they're going to have a really bad time anyway then. Taking the Sylvanas and Vala early on, I don't know why. Maybe taking the Sylvanas is okay if you're going to do something special with her.
Mm-hmm.
But leaving Taranda, Uther, Diablo all up on the board when they already have the Jaina, that's just leaving yourself really, really open.
Yeah, it's leaving a lot of cash on the table. So they do pick up the Diablo, which is, good because they need to counter out that Taranda, Diablo. But they pick up a Tassadar. That's not absolutely terrible, especially not on Cursed Hollow. Diablo's still, even though you don't have the Taranda to get that really nice synergy, or the Uther to get this stun synergy, he still works really well in these long hallway maps where you just kind of just have to body block and you get that section off no matter what, as long as you can just knock out the ability for that person to escape. Taranda, Jaina, but there's a Divine Shield coming out here as well, so it's gonna be difficult for them to get that pick.
If you're putting yourself in that situation where you're just trying to body block, that means you're in range of the other four people on the other team, so
that's true.
They're just gonna chain the Taranda and the Jaina marks on you and you're just gonna die. And they actually went for the ETC there. I thought they might go for something a little bit more aggressive to try and set up kills with the Tyranda, Uth, or Jaina. But the ETC is like the safe, solid, stable pick. And I don't know. They have a really, really strong lineup in general. And a Brightwing.
And a Brightwing.
I don't know why the Brightwing. Like, it's not bad, but I don't see why. Why you would take it over a Rhaegar, particularly, or a Malfurion. A Rhaegar definitely would have been the better pick.
The disengage?
If you're going Emerald Wind, though, you have, like, zero healing.
Yeah, it's true.
It's already going to be so hard for them to keep anyone alive against Jaina. I really don't know.
Against Jaina Tyranda at that.
Yeah.
Especially as soon as Uther gets any type of stun as well, it's going to be very difficult for them to keep anybody alive. They do have the cleanse, though, from Brightwing, so maybe that's why they're going for it.
Yeah, I guess that's the only thing that really makes too much sense, is having the cleanse for the Tyranda and Uther and whatnot.
Yeah, maybe possibly if, you know, if there's a mosh pit. No, it's going to be a mosh pit. It's going to be stage dive. It's Cursed Hollow.
Yeah. Well, Keith does have a really, really strong pushing lineup with the Sylvanas, Zavala, Tassadar. He can go for something there. And they can always have the Brightwing just kind of AFK top and blink in if Murlocs try and go too ham trying to punish it. So I mean, they can maybe make something happen early on. Because it's not like they... With the ETC, you're not going to be roaming around threatening kills everywhere like you would with the Diablo.
Yeah.
It's not nearly as scary of a combo.
But even then, as soon as they see a stage dive coming in there, they can have that, you know, Emerald Wind just immediately go down, section off the stage dive from getting too much of a bonus on the end of, on your team. Or, you know, potentially just start immediately polymorphing the enemy team. It's just... I can see it as a good disengage tool or possibly sectioning off tool, but already they already have that Diablo. I don't know. It's going to be interesting, but at the same time, I can see that it's definitely coming to be like a good mix-up, I guess, for what we normally see. We'll see. We'll see exactly just what they're able to do with this.
Yeah, I kind of feel like Murloc's lineup is just stronger. And also the fact that we don't recognize any of the players on the other team. I'm not sure if they really have like some kind of plan going to this draft that we're just not really seeing. Or if they're just not so comfortable drafting. Because that Diablo pick, like, they don't really have any synergy with it. It was 100% just to deny it. And they had to do that at that point. Like, yeah. They didn't really have much of a choice, but it just doesn't fit so well into the rest of their team.
Yeah, I have to agree there. I mean, Diablo's a really difficult hero to work with already. I mean, like, I'm the solo queue master with Diablo, and it's just, like, the things that you have to do to try and force Diablo to work with any team that doesn't have, you know, people who are able to kind of follow up with Diablo, it's like, all right, well, I guess we're just going to kind of possibly just not win this game until I get Firestorm later on.
but yeah, they don't actually have a stun to follow him up, like, unless they go Reign of Vengeance, and even then it's only Reign of Vengeance. Like, they only have the Polymorph to mark.
Yeah, that's...
The Diablo's just not going to be setting up kills. He's just going to be there as a tank, and I guess maybe Apoc.
Yeah, I guess... well, they could go for... No, I guess they really couldn't go for Lightning Breath. There's not really a huge advantage out of that. There's nobody who's melee they could really kind of ward off. And the disengage they've already got with Emerald Wind if they do go for that instead of going for the Blink Heal. So there's a couple of things. Loading screen taking a little bit of time to go through here. But once we do get onto this game, guys, this is going to be the first game of the best of three between Murlocs and Murlocs Geniuses. God, it's going to take a couple of seconds to get ready for this one. Murloc Geniuses as well as for Keith McGreefs. So let's get on into the main screen. So over here on the left-hand side, we have Murloc Geniuses, the combined efforts of Murlocs Incorporated, Evil Geniuses, and Caterpillar.
And Roger.
And Echo, and it's just a mix-match team. So they're going to be in the blue trunks over here on the left, and over here on the right-hand side, we do have our friends Keith McBrief, all caps. I always respect teams that go all caps, like Barrel Boys, except they were all caps in all spaces. But now Barrel Boys, of course, are going to be Complexity. So let's get on into this match. Jungle Clean going to be going on to the top lane. Melee is going to be Queen... Crone?
Crone, yeah.
Crone. Insane's going to be backing. He's Diablo. And we've got Vlah and My Red Scarf going to be sitting down in the bot lane. Meanwhile, four Murloc Geniuses Echo on ETC. A four-man stock of Rajar, Mad Timmy, Koth on Luck, and Faye in the mid lane.
Yeah, they're just going to put a little bit of pressure on the mid lane, thus send Zagara up top. And Zagara against Brightwing, that'll be a very fun matchup for her. I don't know what they're going to plan on doing about that, because they're kind of running around themselves. They don't have the Vala, Tassadar, Sylvanas like stacked in the lane to do a lot of pushing. Mm-hmm. So I just don't know what value Keith is going to get out of the early game, whereas Murlocs is happy to just run around and let Zagara win top eventually, which will happen.
And that's one thing that I know at least Evil Geniuses was always very, very fond of, was just making sure that they get that perfect rotation between capturing all the experience of one lane, then going up to another lane, and just kind of keeping their group very, very solidified, generally 3 to 4 people all at once.
Yeah, that kind of thing is really, really powerful on some maps, but not so much on here, because the lanes are just too far apart
right. To
really do it.
Red Scarf is going to be able to disengage there by using the escape mechanism on Sylvanas, so just going to keep this, I guess, a three-man lane against three person, so just kind of even it out, trying to deny as much damage from that Sylvanas.
Yeah, I'd be surprised if Sylvanas is really able to do much. Murlocs does have kill potential if anyone gets too far forward, particularly like a Sylvanas, but as long as they sit back and wait, like, Murlocs can't actually make anything happen. They're just going to be putting out poke damage with the Tyranda and Jaina. It seems like it's going to be a pretty passive early game, except we do have Zagara zoning out the Brightwing up top, and Vol's going to come up and try and help her out, but the creep should see that coming.
But that's going to force the Diablo to have to take over a mid lane, which, again, you know, we say this a couple of times, Diablo, really strong roamer, not the greatest laner. I mean, he is going against Mad Timmy's Uther, so, I mean, I don't think, you know, Uther's going to be pushing too hard, but even then, he's got to be careful. Looks like Mad Timmy's just...
Uther's the best solo laner in the game.
Oh, yeah, that's what I meant. I meant, like, he's not pushing too hard. It looks like he's actually trying to bait Diablo into being in the middle of the lane.
Yeah. Yeah, I watched Kawhi play Uther. He wins, like, a solo lane against any assassin. It's really weird.
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, especially against a Diablo. Diablo has no lane, like, except for unless, you know, you're able to overpower and shadow charge somebody into towers. But, okay, great. So, Krohn did come back down. Gonna be able to have to keep this lane a little bit more in their favor now here for Keep the Grief. And General Clean still trying to deal with Koth on luck.
Yeah, Zagara is kind of... Well, actually, taking a decent amount of damage, and the Brightwing is full health, so it is pretty hard to trade harass with the Brightwing, so normally Zagara would just be pushing this lane in or zoning her out, but it's pretty difficult to do that when the rest of the team is roaming up to try and deal with you. First tribute spawns, it's bottom, so Murlocs has to be really careful here, because the Brightwing can always come in. Zagara's not going to be there anytime soon. Murlocs really just looking to delay this for as long as possible, hoping Zagara gets something down up top. Plus, they are getting that mid soak.
Yeah, they're getting mid and top soak pretty well, and Zagara's just doing so much damage up in that top lane. So the longer they just wait this out, they're going to get a couple of towers. The closer they get to that level 7, if they get level 7, that's going to be a free tribute for them on the second run, too.
Yeah, and it's definitely looking like that's going to happen. Well, they're thinking about sending the ball back mid, but kind of indecisive from them, and they've pretty much given up their advantage around this. They've taken on too much damage. We got a healing ward down from Murlocs, so Murlocs actually winning the HP battle pretty solidly, plus Walla being pulled back to deal with the Uther. Now, this is kind of getting to the weird point where, like, there's games where the first tribute isn't actually taken until, like, level 10 is reached, just because neither team really wants to commit to it. Mm-hmm. I can see that happening here, just because neither team is really in the best position to fight for it.
Yeah, nobody really wants to make anything happen out of this. It's just Insane and Echo going back and forth. It's just warrior versus warrior. A little bit of backwalking going on here, but level 7's been grabbed here by Murloc's Geniuses. That's going to give them a pretty good talent advantage.
Yeah, they got that, and they have the Zagara, who, like we said, just keep doing work. The first tower is going to be going down pretty quickly up there.
Insane. Going to get caught. Echo going to be able to body block and lock him out, and that's going to be first blood here for Murloc Geniuses.
Yep, and that was kind of the tipping point there. They'll obviously be able to secure that tribute pretty freely. Zagara continuing to push in top, and Uther actually has been winning the trades pretty handily against the Vol as well, mid, including denying some experience. So it's kind of everything going Murloc's way right now.
Yeah, they're getting just advantages absolutely all over. Keith McGreef in a little bit of a difficult spot. It looks like they're going to pick up the Sylvanas as well. Red Scarf going to go down. Just out of health and mana.
Oh, but Mad Timmy might be dying mid. Nope, just enough heal to get him through it. So tower is being pushed down in both lanes. Kills going down everywhere. They're going to have 10 for... they'll be able to make something happen with the second and third tributes, maybe go for a boss after the second, something like that. They're going to have a big, big lead headed into 10. And Keith really just kind of nothing going for them. They don't really have any control over the map, and Zagara's already starting to spread creep everywhere.
Taking a look at the talents real quick, we do have a Sylvanas build with Unstable Poison as well as with the Wind and Envenom coming out here at level 4. I just want to point that out because she's a rather new hero, so a lot of people are still kind of moving around on what type of talents to grab her on for her builds. It looks like we have a tribute coming in here for the top lane. Rajar going to be able to get that uncontested.
Yeah, they kind of went for it, but there was no way they were going to be able to really fight that. If the two teams had danced for any amount... Ooh, the ball might be down here. If the two teams had danced for any amount of time, Murlocs would have taken 10 and then just kind of wiped them. So Heath really just kind of has to sit back and wait it out at this point. They're down 10 for a whole level, so it's going to be really tough for them.
This is going to be a lot of map control going to be coming out of here for Murloc Geniuses that they can just exercise freely. They have no big worries about anything from Keith McGreep just yet. Keith McGreep just have to soak all those lanes and possibly get some sort of advantage and get back into this game. But at that time, as soon as they start getting those heroics back out there, it's a pretty big leap between level 10 and level 13. Ooh, Cough on Luck actually getting overpowered a little bit too forward. He's going to try and get out of here. Does Crone actually have the multi-shot to finish this off? The Maw, though, is going to save him. Very nicely played there by Cough on Luck.
The Maw and a creep. Without the regen and without the speed boost, he doesn't survive that, so. And they actually wasted a decent amount of time trying to chase him down there where they could have been pushing. They lost the Ford up top, so not a very good trade there. And Cawthon's going to be back out for the next tribute. However, Maw is down. He hasn't gone. Oh, Maw is dead.
Wow. Crone going a little bit too far forward, and Murloc Genius is going to take that. Yeah, we take those two.
That's what happens when you have a Jaina. Sometimes people just die. Pretty cool. Diablo might get it.
Yeah, Diablo taking a little bit of damage. He's going to have to back up. Oh. Murloc Genius is taking a really confident push on this map. They're doing really well with their map control.
Yeah, they can push in here pretty freely. We are going to have the ball back out there soon, but I don't know if Keith really wants to fight anyway. If they dance for too long here, their lancers can push. But they're still stacking up everyone mid, so they pretty much have to fight because they're going to be losing both the outer lanes as well.
Yeah, you have to be really careful about it in this situation, though, because you think that the fort's going to be able to help you out. It's like a general, like, safety net that everybody feels like, but when the curse is on there, the fort's not going to do anything for you. And it seems really obvious to say that, but sometimes you just have, like,
It's easy to forget, yeah. You see your buildings, you're like, this is my safe zone.
Exactly.
No, it's not right now.
However, I mean, Murloc Genius is playing really nice and passively. They're not really trying to go for anything too crazy. They are just soaking. They know as soon as they hit level 13, they're going to have a massive map advantage.
Plus, they have a gigantic wave pushing in bottom. They're going to get that fort for free if they can just keep Keith occupied. Even top is pushing, getting some damage onto that keep wall. And ECC now sitting back up for his split push. He's going to try and take down that bottom fort. And everyone else is going for boss. This is a good call by them. They weren't going to be able to accomplish any more in the rest of the curse.
Right, so especially with Echo being able to push in that bot lane just kind of for free. Yeah. They actually might still pick it up. No. Oh, wow. Well, Sylvanas's trait, yeah, just gonna block out those creeps, stun them for too long. But once the boss gets grabbed,
yeah, that boss is gonna push in for free. It'll kill that keep immediately, or kill that fort immediately, and then start pushing in. They can actually rotate up and start contesting the top golem now. Looks like that is exactly what they'll do. And they should be leaving the ETC bot. Yeah, the ETC is gonna stay bot and just split push in with that golem. And then as soon as Keith responds to the golem, then they can just take the top golem for free. So
yes,
absolutely perfect situation for Murlocs here.
That's one of those things that, as soon as you see that the enemy is at one point on the minimap, I mean, right now everybody's in the fog of war. You don't know where Keith McGreef is. They could be going for that golem. So that's why Murloc Genius is playing very passively until they see Keith McGreef answering this golem with more than two people. Then they know that they have the team advantage. They see three, four people sitting down here. Huh. Actually, Murloc Genius is...
Yeah, that's kind of surprising. I figured they would have just camped the golem and gone for it immediately. They certainly have the time to do it. Yeah, that's not bad as well. That just keeps growing your XP lead. But because if you're ahead going forward in the game and the golem's responding at the same time, that's not the best for you. You'd like them to be staggered so you can use your advantage to secure both of them.
Right.
So I guess maybe they're thinking that.
That's probably true, because especially if they lose later on and they give up a double golem to the enemy team. Maybe.
It looks like they're gunning for it now. I guess they just wanted to secure that fort and get a little bit more XP before they went for the fight. It kind of feels like a wasted opportunity if they wanted to have the golem now, though. They certainly could have gone for it while they were defending bottom.
So level 13 has been grabbed here by Murloc Geniuses. They're sitting in a really good spot, though. I mean, they've got double sprint coming down here that's going to give them a lot more escape on Tyrande and Jaina, as well as the shrink ray coming down here on Uther, just kind of limit the amount of damage that the...
Brightwing's out of position.
Brightwing taking a lot of damage. Are they going to be able to actually capitalize on that? Doesn't look like it.
He does have Blink Heal. He could have always hopped out to a minion.
That's true.
Oh no, he has Emerald Wind. Never mind. Oh. He hasn't used Emerald Wind yet. I wonder why he went Emerald. The tributes are starting to spawn again.
Didn't go cleanse either. Went for Gust of Healing.
Yeah, I don't know. That's an odd build.
An interesting build.
ETC might get caught out down here. He does have Sage Dive, but you don't really want to burn that just to escape. He's kind of out of position here.
Especially against a Diablo.
They know about it, too.
Yeah. Or the stun. Oh, actually, it looks like they want to go in on Bay, taking a lot of damage. Here comes so much damage coming in here from the Jaina. The Maw actually going to do a lot of work as well. Here comes ETC. Power slide to stun everybody. And that's an absolutely massive pickup and clean for Murloc Geniuses.
Yeah, Diablo is way too far out there, and a four-man Maw on top of it. Plus, they just kind of ignored the ETC, who was, like, completely split from his team. Not the best team fighting from Keith McBrief there.
Yeah, it looks like they're going to be able to pick up this Trippie pretty quickly, and that's going to be, you know, a little bit of an advantage here. But not only that, they're going to go straight for these Keep Towers as well.
Yep, you got that Zagara. Have Jaina coming in eventually. Jaina, with her crit now applying to the buildings, is actually a pretty decent pusher. But the thing is, death timers at this point are so short, it's not really safe for them to go for that keep unless they want to take another team fight at this point.
Right.
And they're about to have 16. They can do that if they really want to, but it looks like they're just going to back off and play it safe.
Which is smart. That's a really good idea. You know, just kind of back up, play it safe, come back in another day. 16 to 13, that whole talent lead. I mean, zero kills still for Keith McGree.
They're going to ambush him here at the Giants. This is going to be messy.
Yeah, Brightwing does have Emerald Wind up, but doesn't even get to use it. Does get stunned out of it. Looks like she did queue it up, but it doesn't actually go down. Siege Giant's going to get grabbed here by Murloc's Geniuses. Wow, that's so difficult to not say Murloc Sing.
I just call him Murloc, so I'm not even trying. And this should be like 5-on-3 with a couple of Giants pushing in, plus a huge level lead. This should be a pretty free keep. And they can rotate up for the top boss, plus the tribute.
Diablo losing the Lightning Breath, trying to zone them out, but it's just not possible here. Guav trying to throw down the shield as well. Here comes a Strafe from Krohn. But even then, Echo now going to go straight on in here. Rar Jar popping down the Elemental, but doesn't look like it's going to grab Insane. They're going to pick up the keep and just back straight on up.
Yeah, all five up, and they did blow some cooldowns. They do want to just back off here, but there's plenty for them to do out on the map. They got the keep, so definitely a massive win for them. Looks like they're headed for the Knights. Oh, they're being very, very cautious about going for that top golem. It feels like they have enough of a level lead that as soon as Elemental's back up, they can go for it. But they might just try and play it safe and wait for their bottom golem.
Yeah, I mean, especially with the tribute up, they're going to have golems up in... Okay, yeah, 30 seconds. Yeah, you're right. oh, wow. Echo dances in front of the tribute, cancels his tribute grabbing, and dances in front of it.
It's an interesting decision by him.
I think he's just trying to... be a little bit madder.
He's just trying to create space. He's trying to taunt them into coming up there so then they can get the bottom golem for free in 10 seconds.
Maybe he just wants the entire enemy team to start dancing with him. He is ETC, the rock god.
Yeah.
He's going to keep on. So the rest of Keith McGreef going to go over here, grab up the Bruiser camp, and potentially make a fight for the golem. Oh man. It was actually a little bit of a hint of a worry there that they weren't going to be able to get those bruises because Murlocs were just kind of coming in on that really quickly.
That would have been pretty bad. Double Knights pushing mid while that boss is up. But they did get it. They should be able to push out mid with a Brightwing and just dance up here. Nothing should really happen, but bottom will push eventually. That is the danger of having that keep down, so they cannot just dance forever.
Right, but so
this is just such a terrible position. They can't come into this. They're all split and they're being funneled through a choke against the Jaina. They had to give it.
And that's going to be a tribute.
That was actually a second curse, but wow, that was fast.
Yeah, this is going to be third tribute, second curse. And Sane trying to give a little bit of a gap here for his team. Keith McGreep in a little bit of a difficult spot. Siege Giant's going to be pushing down the top lane. Meanwhile, in the middle lane, they've got full Bruiser Camp being able to push down as well with all five men. So they've got a lot of resources that they've got to dedicate to a lot of different lanes, and meanwhile in the bot lane comes in the siege, the catapult as well, with the keep down already from there from before. Murloc Geniuses is sitting in a really good spot. They're able to do a lot of damage here.
Yeah, and they're playing this really conservatively. They're not even looking to force a fight. They would probably win a fight if it happened, but they're just trying to dance, let the lanes push, and wait for a favorable engagement. Playing really, really careful. And Vala's getting kind of far out. She's got to be careful. Jaina can actually just one-shot her at this point.
Sentry drones going down absolutely everywhere, trying to get as much vision as possible. But they already have the creep everywhere already. Level 16 has been grabbed here by Keith McGreef. They pick up a double Blood for Blood. It's going to help them take down Echo if they have to. Here comes the Lightning Breath to try and zone everybody out, but Insane taking so much damage. The Maw coming down here, going to knock out half the backline. And Insane actually looks like he's going to go down the Starfall, doing so much damage. Bois has to use his shift to get out. It looks like Echo's just going to be able to create enough space. They did get the Zagara, though.
Yeah, it was a one-for-one. Diablo's actually back up. They didn't end up losing another keep, even though it's very, very low and will die eventually. So that was about as big of a win as I think you could hope for as Keith in that situation. But at this point, it looks like Murlocs are probably going to be happy to trade bosses and then go in and finish off that middle fort while they push. It's kind of the same situation we saw in that Garden Terror last series. They just have so much map control, so much material advantage. They can do whatever they want as long as they don't feed their entire team away three times.
Yeah, as long as they're staying together, I mean, that's really all they really need to do is just make sure that they don't get caught out, and that's exactly what they're doing. They're just kind of staying together, making sure they're going to have 4 to 5 people all at once, and they're going to force an engagement no matter how, like, what happens. I mean, that Golem, if Murloc changes it, doesn't even have to really worry about it too much. It's just going to go through a fort. That's
yeah.
Its gates and towers still there, so all, you know, Murlocs has to do is just kind of make this a question of where is Keith McGreef going to have to dedicate their resources. Wherever they dedicate them, they're going to be at the opposite spot.
Yep. Murlocs can just go in and breathe on that middle keep and they'll die, and then they can go siege the top. Oh, the ball actually could have gotten caught, but I'm missing the slide. The keep is already down, and that Golem's just going to keep on pushing in. They can rotate up and finish off that middle keep, or the core will just die to the Golem. So, really, really tough situation for Keith here.
Yeah, it looks like, yeah, I mean, there's not really much they can do here. Yeah, they're going to go straight in for that top keep as well. So that's going to be 3 keeps down here. Keith McGreef in a really rough situation. As soon as that level 20 is gained as well, it's going to be even worse. But here comes another tribute. They don't have a single tribute.
Nope, they haven't gotten a tribute all game. They actually just kind of haven't accomplished much of anything all game. They pushed down, like, the mid wall. That's about it. I guess their goal is getting top fort now.
Top keep, man. Look at him. He's actually still pretty decently chunked. He's fine.
I mean, yeah, it's a 17-minute Golem, and it's been uncontested besides the building, so takes a while to kill. Murlocs, it looked like they were kind of trying to bait Knights, but Rajar was having none of it. He just wanted that tribute.
I mean, even with just 4 of the members there, they easily could have gotten at least a first kill, and that would have been a 4v4 after that.
Yeah. The keep is actually taking damage from the Golem in a decent minion wave. If they don't come back and defend that, it's going to die. Well, I think it's going to die regardless at this point.
Everything dies, Idra.
Eventually. It's dying much faster than it really needed to, though. I'm not sure why they chose to give that up. They could have defended it for sure, and they haven't accomplished anything.
They might have misunderstood, or at least underestimated, how much damage that Golem did as much as I did.
Yeah. Yeah, uncontested. If they just picked up, like, the Giants before, so that was doing damage to it or something, then it would have been fine. But
yeah.
It was just with nothing contesting it. Not that it matters.
That does force them to have to dedicate a couple of resources to go into the back line of their own, you know, their mercenary camps. Meanwhile, they just want to kind of pressure Keith McGreef the entire time. So,
yeah.
I mean...
Oh, they're going
wow.
To win now.
Here comes General Kleem, going to get immediately eliminated. Now Insane in the middle of all of Murloc's geniuses. There's going to be a huge amount of damage going down on him. Cough on Luck now finally getting into the fight. Echo doing a really good amount of body blocking. Is he going to stay alive? Yes, just barely he's going to be able to get out of there. Rajar taking a lot of damage. He's going to take so much. Is he going to go down? No, the last second heal coming in here from Mad Timmy. But the Vala's going to fall. Keith McGreef now down 2 members. Diablo did die but came back up immediately. Echo trying to make a question of whether or not Waz going to be able to get out of here. But the shift is popped. He's going to be able to get out. Shield going down here now on the core. Can they actually make a victory out of this? They've got 2 members down, but they're so incredibly hurt. Murloc Genius is going to back up for now.
Yeah, they didn't have enough HP to go for that. They're just going to back off, play it safe again. 2 people down, free tribute, free camps for them. Let's get the map pushing again and go in for round 2. They do have level 20s now. And the thing is, with that keep down, like if you get wiped, like 2 people were already dead for Keith, so it didn't matter so much there. But with a keep down, if you get wiped, they can actually just go in there. They could run through top and kill your base before you respawn at this point. So, as over as the game seems, it is possible for Murlocs to throw, and they know that, so they're not going to take any stupid risks at that point for no reason.
Just to clarify,
take their easy win.
Because the keep is down from Murloc geniuses, they need to be careful.
Right.
For a second, I was like, well, I mean, yeah, they're not only missing their top keep, but they're missing all their other keeps as well.
I meant, like, the backdoor throw potential.
The backdoor potential for Keith McGreef here.
Yeah.
Which is an interesting thing about Heroes of the Storm is that, you know, that still potentially exists to lose the game just because, you know, one lane is pushed. They've got all their other lanes perfectly up, you know, no problems there, but Just because that top lane is down, there is definitely that backdoor potential. Especially with a Sylvanas there as well.
Murloc's playing it nice and safe, though. They got Vision everywhere. They're just making sure all the lanes are pushing in. We're gonna go back in for round two here. Mm-hmm. Our Giant's pushing bottom, but eventually... That probably won't matter. Actually, it looks like they're gonna clear it up beforehand. Playing very, very safe. I think they really don't want to lose to Keith McGreef.
Well, they do have another tribute coming up, so I guess they're just waiting for... Grief.
Yeah. We gotta get that right. It's important. Our sponsors will get mad at us.
Sponsors, yeah. Sponsors of Keith McBrief. They're probably sponsored by Hanes. Grief's company.
It looks like Murlocs is trying to figure out if they want a backdoor or not. Looks like half the team wants the backdoor, half the team wants to go for the tribute.
Actually, they could have gone for it. I mean, half the team of Keith McBrief did move themselves out of there.
Yeah, they could have, but I mean, they're just going to have a Curse and a Golem right now, so that's just, again, pretty much safe free win.
Echo's sitting there trying to make them feel like they're not going to be safe, but actually Keith McBrief not falling for it at all. But that's okay, because the rest of Murlocs is going to be able to grab this Golem down bot lane. And a 21-minute Golem, I mean, we saw how much damage it was able to walk through a fort and a keep. Guess what it can do to a core by itself.
Yeah. No, there's no way. Like, even if the entire team just instantly died from Murlocs right here, like they were dead now, and they ran across the map to try and kill the core, I don't know if they would still be able to win. So, it's not looking too good for Keith.
Good old Keith. Let's see if they can actually make something, I mean, something miraculous come out of this.
Let's see if they can get a kill before they die. That's the objective for Keith McReese here.
Keith, can you get a kill before you die? That's the question here. Insane trying to defend that top lane. Tribute, the curse is just about to go up. They've got another 7 seconds before that's going to fall. There is a beautiful Lunar Flare going down here. General Clean taking so much damage. Here comes a stage dive to try and section him off, but Echo is immediately polymorph. There we go. There is the victory coming out here from Murloc Geniuses. Game number one.
They didn't get the kill. They failed us.
No, they didn't.
Nope,
no, you're right.
Not a one. Jaina almost died.
Jaina almost died. So close.
To be fair, they had like 3 bolts and a divine shield. Like, the kill probably wasn't supposed to happen there.
All right, so we're going to run to another game right after this quick commercial break so we get everything set up for the next game, and then we'll be right back. Game number two here of the round of 16, Keith McBrief versus Murlocs Geniuses. Stay tuned.